What is internal flow? I do not think I need to deal with this very much. In internal flow, I have the pipe, the flow going through a pipe. The pipe can be circular pipe, square pipe, rectangular pipe, trapezoidal pipe, or any shape which you can think of. Now, the important concept which we need to understand in case of non-circular pipes is hydraulic diameter. Hydraulic diameter is 4 into wetted area upon perimeter, that is what is stated here. Why do I multiply this 4 here? Because for circular pipe, if I put area, I get pi d squared by 4 upon wetted perimeter is pi d. So, pi gets cancelled, d gets cancelled, I get d by 4. To make this d by 4 d, I multiply that with 4, because for circular pipe at least I should be getting the hydraulic diameter as back as pipe diameter. That is the reason we multiply by area by 4, and now you can go on doing this for square duct and rectangular duct. So, food for thought, what will be the hydraulic diameter for flow between two parallel plates? I will take up this, but I want you to keep thinking on that. Now, let us come to mean velocity. There are two concepts which we need to understand, that is mean velocity and bulk mean temperature. So, in the mean velocity, what is there in the mean velocity? We have, what is mean velocity? Mean velocity is nothing but the average velocity. How do I get the average velocity? Most of the times you remember, for getting the average velocity, we measure the mass flow rate. That is, if the flow is flowing in a pipe, let us say in a tap water, you just take it below the, you collect that in a 1 liter box. You collect it for whatever time it takes for collecting 1 liter, you note down the time and you have taken 1 liter, you know the density, so you can calculate the mass flow rate. If you divide it by density and area, you are going to get the velocity. What is this velocity? It is nothing but the average velocity. But is the velocity going to be same? Is the velocity going to be, the velocity profile going to be same everywhere? No. That is, velocity profile is going to be parabolic if it is laminar, and cap profile if it is going to be turbulent. Let me just draw it for the heck of it, because I have not shown you so far internal flows. In internal flows, of course, we are going to derive this in today, little later. We are going to get, if the, this is the flow, we are going to get laminar. If it is laminar, we are going to get, this is the parabolic profile. This is for, parabolic profile is for laminar flow, parabolic. If it is turbulent, top hat profile I am going to get. If it is turbulent, I am going to get top hat profile. Let me see, I think in the subsequent slides I have this. Let me first state those basics and then come back. So, I need to give you some basics and then come back, because we need to understand what are the basics of fully developed flow, developing flow and things like that. So, we know what is laminar, what is transitional, what is turbulent. This is what we have studied in the last to last class. Laminar is goes in laminar, and in transitional sometimes it is laminar and sometimes it is turbulent, and for turbulent velocity is fluctuating with time. And that is what is being shown here in turbulent flow. Now, this was first found by Osborne Reynolds in 1883. So, it is few hundred, at least 100 years back. Now, there is another important concept what is called as developing flow and fully developed flow. What is developing flow? In developing flow, the boundary layer is growing, and once the boundary layer reaches the center of the pipe, then subsequent to that, the velocity profile does not change with streamwise direction or the direction of the flow. Till here you see it was uniform profile which it has entered. Here you see at the center it is bulged and at the walls it is lesser. Why? Because this is uniform, the velocity has decreased near the walls. Why has it decreased? Because of the boundary layer. Now, it has to compensate. So, to compensate for that, near the center it has to get bulged. So, now that bulging goes on increasing as we move on, because my velocity profile is becoming flatter and flatter, and then it is going to become, sorry, it is going to not flatter and flatter, it is going towards parabolic from the flat profile. So, we get a parabolic profile once my boundary layer reaches the center line of the pipe. So, from this, the location at which it reaches the center line, center location, center of the pipe, is that length is the called as the hydrodynamic entrance length or developing length. This is what I am talking for velocity, not for temperature. This is hydrodynamic developing length. Similarly, we will define what is called as thermally developing length. This is hydrodynamically developing length. It has been found that L by D, that is the hydrodynamic developing length, is around 0.06 times the Reynolds number for laminar flow, and for turbulent flow it is 4.4 re to the power of 1 by 6 for turbulent flow. Because there is one question always my student asks, always few students ask us, that is, will I have developing flow for turbulent flow also, or developing flow concept is only for laminar flow? Developing flow concept is there for both laminar and turbulent. There is nothing specific for laminar or turbulent. So, for laminar flow, in fact, it takes longer developing length compared to that of the turbulent flow. For turbulent flow, general thumb rule is that you take 25 times the pipe diameter, generally we get the fully developed pipe flow, fully developed velocity profile, that is the top hat profile for turbulent flow. But for laminar flow, if the Reynolds number is around 2000, you can see that the developing length is quite large, 120 times the diameter of the pipe. So, it is very large as opposed to turbulent flow. So, that is developing flow concept. Another important thing is that the pressure drop, the pressure, if I were to put the pressure tabs on the walls of this pipe and plot that pressure distribution, that is the static pressure distribution. What is static pressure distribution? Static pressure is that pressure which is experienced by the fluid when I sit, is the pressure experienced by me when I sit on the fluid and I am traveling along with it. That means there is no dynamic component. Whatever molecular collision is happening on the fluid particle while it is moving, that is static pressure. So, that static pressure, if I were to plot with length of the pipe, you can see that there is a nonlinear pressure drop in the entrance flow, that is in the developing flow. Later on, the pressure drop is linear. Okay? So, this is what is we, that is how we identify whether it is fully developed flow or developing flow very easily, even not even without measuring the velocity profile. So, that is what is being shown here. For turbulent flow, naturally we have said that it picks up and then you have all sorts of initially laminar, then transitional and then turbulent. This is velocity with time or Reynolds numbers with time. So, I think there is nothing new. The point here I want to tell again here is that I want to define what is called as hydrodynamically smooth pipe. I know I am going to fluid mechanics back again, because whatever fluid mechanics required for internal flow pipes, I am trying to cover here. Okay. So, what is hydraulically smooth pipe? This is the term most of us would have come across. What is hydraulically smooth pipe? Hydraulically smooth pipe is that pipe in which the surface roughness, in which the surface roughness is lesser than the laminar sublayer thickness. If the surface roughness is less than the laminar sublayer thickness, then we will be, then it is called hydraulically smooth. Why? Because if it is hydro, when I say hydraulically smooth, the flow just smoothly goes over it. There is no boundary layer getting disturbed, because the surface roughness is lesser than the laminar sublayer thickness. My boundary layer structure do not get disturbed because of this surface roughness. Only when the surface roughness is greater than, if the surface roughness is greater than the, if the surface roughness is greater than laminar sublayer thickness, then it is going to be, what is it called? What is it called? Hydraulically rough pipe. Remember, this is not geometrically rough. Hydraulically smooth pipe is actually geometrically rough, but it is not hydraulically smooth. But here if the my geometrical roughness is greater than laminar sublayer thickness, then it is called as hydraulically rough pipe. That means it is breaking the laminar sublayer. Now I am going to have only the turbulent boundary layer or maybe the buffer layer. Okay. So with this, that is what again we come back and it helps us in understanding this hydraulically smooth pipe and rough pipe. Okay. So this was what was taught in the last class. So now if I take, okay, I have not yet given the velocity profile. So we will come to this velocity profile and the friction factor derivation little later. With these fundamentals, let us go to the concept of mean velocity, So here in the mean velocity, what is that we are doing? I am not going to write this. Okay. So this is m dot equal to rho a v. So if I take the integration, area integral rho v r x d a c. Why r comma x I have taken? Because velocity profile can change with streamwise location and also with radius. This definition is not specific to only for fully developed flow. Even in developing flow, I can have the mean velocity. So average velocity equal to 1 upon rho a c in the numerator integral of rho v r comma x d a c. So if I take a small elemental ring, that ring diameter is 2 pi r and ring radius is d r. So I have rho v r comma x 2 pi r d r integrated within the limits 0 to r. Then what will I get? So I get 2 pi pi gets cancelled out, 2 rho rho. If I take the rho outside, that is rho is not varying with the location. If I make that assumption, if I take the rho outside, I get 2 by r squared 0 to r v r comma x r d r. That is for incompressible flow. The very fact that I am taking rho outside means it is incompressible flow. Density is not varying with space. That is the assumption I have made. So this definition is for incompressible flow. If it is for the compressible flow, the density variation also I have to take into account within the integral. So I get 2 by r squared 0 to r v r comma x r d r. So that is what I get the average velocity. So now let me go ahead. Now that I have defined mean velocity, let me go for fundamentals of fluid dynamics and then come back to heat transfer. Okay. So if I take flow in a circular pipe, this is a circular pipe, I have v z r and theta direction, r theta z direction. This is polar coordinates or cylindrical coordinate. It is varying with radius. At a given radius it is varying with theta, and this r and theta can be different at different z's. That is the streamwise location. Instead of taking x, I have taken it as z. Now what are the continuity equation? Del v r by del r plus 1 by r del v theta by del theta plus del v z by del z plus v r by r equal to 0. Now v theta is not there, it is viscous incompressible steady flow. I have for steady flow, this is the equation what I get for v r and v theta. For a fully developed flow, if I take fully developed flow, v theta is 0, v theta and v r are 0, only v z is varying with radius. That is the streamwise velocity is varying with radius. V r and v theta is 0. So v r and v theta is 0, v z is only a function of r. So continuity equation, in the continuity equation what will happen? Del v z by del z is equal to 0. So I get only del v r, and del v theta by del theta is also not there. So then, because it is symmetric, so and then this, in this equation what will happen? For this equation is not there because v r is not there, and this equation is not there because v theta is not there. That is, momentum equation for v r and momentum equation for v theta is not there. Then I have to take the momentum equation for only v z, and pressure is only a function of z, not r and theta, because there is no theta momentum equation and r momentum equation. So if this is my equation, so So, I get V r del V z by del r plus V theta by r, V theta is not there. So, this term is vanishing, and what about del V z by del r? It is symmetric. So, this is 0. So, this is not there, and del V z by del z, if I take fully developed flow, velocity is not varying with stream wise direction. So, this term is not there, and V z is not a function of theta. So, if I with this thing, so full left hand side is 0, I get minus 1 by rho del p by del z plus nu of all these terms. In this again, V z is not a function of theta, and V z is not a function of z. V z only is a function of r, that is the definition of fully developed flow. So, if I integrate, this is the equation I get. If I integrate this and apply boundary conditions, that is at r equal to 0, d V z by d r equal to 0, that means it is symmetric, and at r equal to r, V z equal to 0, this is no slip boundary condition. If I substitute these no slip boundary conditions, I am going to get the velocity profile like this, which is nothing but paraboloid, that is minus r squared by 4 mu d p by d z. So, still d p by d z is not known. Let us keep that. If I take in this as z equal to, that is r equal to 0, V z maximum, that is at the center line velocity, I am going to get this as minus r squared by 4 mu d p by d z, that is what is V z maximum. If I substitute this here in this equation, I get V z equal to V z maximum into 1 minus r by r whole squared. This is the parabolic velocity profile. Why did I come here? Because I wanted to show you how to compute the average velocity, which is what I just defined 2 minutes back. The average velocity is 1 by pi r squared, 0 to 2 pi, 0 to r, V z r d r d theta. There is a small elemental ring. That is, if I integrate this d theta, I get 2 pi r. I had taken in one shot there 2 pi r. I am showing here it is 2 pi r, that is r d r, you get 2 pi upon pi r squared. If you integrate this all through, which you can do it yourself, if you integrate this, you are going to get that as V z average equal to V z maximum by 2. So, this is the basic thing which is what we check when we do the velocity profile. So, then you can calculate the shear stress also, tau equal to mu d V z by d r. You are going to get that shear stress in terms of average velocity, and if you reduce that in terms of Reynolds number, you will be getting 16 by r e. This is fluid mechanics, this is not heat transfer, that is why I have gone quite fast. I think it's reasonable to go fast here. I would expect you to work out all these steps. We have not skipped even a single step, plus and minus, multiplication, everything is there in transparencies 22 to 29. Please sit down and calculate this, you will realize every step is self explanatory. If you get any doubt, please put them across in Moodle, we will answer that. That is CF equal to 16 by RE. Only one thing I need to tell here, there is another thing which is defined, what is called as friction factor. One is skin friction factor, another one is Darcy's friction factor. Darcy's friction factor is 4 times the skin friction factor. In most of the textbooks, both are used as F only, but we need to realize whenever you see 16 by RE, it is 16, it is skin friction factor. Whenever you see 64 by RE, it is Darcy's friction factor. So, this is what always confuses us, we should not be getting confused. Yes. So, this is non-dimensional, CF is the non-dimensional shear stress and F is the non-dimensional pressure gradient. Okay. So, I think we have studied this from fundamentals of fluid mechanics. Now, with this, what I will do is, so what I have covered so far is, if I have to take a recap of what I have covered, what did I do? I defined what is internal flow, and I said what is hydraulic diameter. I defined hydraulic diameter, and I said I defined what is average mean velocity, and then I went to the fundamentals of fluid mechanics, that is, I went to what is laminar, turbulent, transitional on a quick note, and then defined what is called as hydrodynamically fully developed flow, that is developing flow and fully developed flow, and how do we differentiate or how do we identify them, and what is the developing length given by, we said, and with that, and I said what is, I defined what is hydraulically smooth pipe and hydraulically rough pipe I defined, and then came to the velocity profile in a circular pipe and took the Navier-Stokes equations and reduced these Navier-Stokes equations for fully developed flow and solved that velocity distribution, solved the Navier-Stokes equation along with continuity equation, substituted appropriate boundary conditions, got the velocity profile and realized that it is parabolic in nature for laminar. Remember, this is laminar flow, and we realized that shear stress is given by, or skin friction coefficient is given by 16 by Re and Darcy's friction factor is given by 64 by Re. So, with this we will move on to what is called as bulk fluid temperature or bulk mean temperature, which is what Professor Arun is going to teach us.
So, good morning. We will study now internal flows from a heat transfer perspective. What we mean by that is, so far Professor had introduced fluid mechanics aspects, solved and obtained the velocity distribution, average velocity, friction factor, coefficient of friction, so on and so forth. And then also there was a definition which is very important from a point of view of average velocity, which is nothing but the number that we come across in most problems, you know. So, actual velocity we know is going to vary with r, with radius and z, but we are saying this so called average velocity is a constant which is defined like this. Okay. Now, if average velocity is defined like this, what about so called average temperature? So, when we say water flows through a pipe with a velocity of 2 meters per second or mass flow rate of 0.2 kg per second and a temperature of 25 degrees centigrade, or let us take a higher temperature, of a temperature of say 80 degrees centigrade. Okay. So, this value that you get is nothing but what is called as an average bulk mean, or textbooks will use this concept called as mixing cup temperature. Average bulk mean or mixing cup temperature. What does this mean? See, this thing is a little bit different from a fluid mechanics definition. Okay. So, how is it different? Let us see. Normally, what do you do when you have a pipe and you are supplying heat? All of us have done high school physics. Water enters at m dot flow rate and say 25 degrees centigrade and say leaves at 60 degrees centigrade. This is a regular high school problem in physics. Okay. So, we will write m dot C p T out minus T in is the amount of energy that has been supplied to the water, and this heat is coming in by means of say an electrical current. Okay. So, some heating, your household water heater, geyser that you have in the bathroom is essentially this kind of a device. So, you increase the flow rate, the water becomes, because the wattage associated with the geyser is fixed. So, this is the power rating that you get from the manufacturer. So, if you are talking of a bathroom for a house which has 4 people, the rating will be very different from what you have for a say a hotel where there are about 100 rooms. So, we are talking of the rating which is fixed now in this case, and as I vary the m dot, my exit temperature is going to change according to the inlet temperature. So, that is why when you want hot water, you reduce the flow rate because you cannot change the power. So, you reduce the flow rate, and as you reduce the flow rate, the water is going to get hotter and hotter. Now, conversely, if you want a cooler water, you increase the flow, keep the tap at as close to maximum operating condition as possible. Of course, in summer, if you see the inlet temperature of water in your overhead tanks in the building, water has already gotten hot by 10 o'clock in the morning. So, if you are putting on the geyser and trying to get hot water, even the regular tap water sometimes is hot enough. Therefore, if you turn on the geyser even at highest flow rate, this T out will be slightly more than what you can bear. Okay. So, this T in T out, what we give to students, what we get in engineering application is what we call as average or bulk mean or mixing cup temperature. Now, let us understand this from fundamentals point of view. See, we always talked about this concept of boundary layer. What does that mean? Before we go to boundary layer, let us say, if this is the pipe, water is getting, this surface is, let us say, at temperature 80 degrees centigrade. I am doing some, by some means, I am keeping the surface temperature constant. So, I know that the fluid closest, we are talking of a circular pipe. Okay. So, the fluid closest to the wall is going to be at about 80, let us say this is 79, next layer would be at 75 and then 60 and then 40 and say the centermost is at 35. Okay, this is your room temperature water. Now, the same fluid, okay, the same fluid, I am taking the same fluid and moving. So, this is called as Lagrangian frame of reference. All of us have studied this in fluid mechanics. Lagrangian frame of reference basically is, you are standing and moving along with the fluid particle. A passenger on the roof of a train or a passenger in the train is basically traveling at the speed of the train. So, that is Lagrangian frame of reference. Okay, so, everything you see is with respect to that particular speed. So, you are a particle in the flow field. The person in the train is a particle, the train compartment is the moving train is the flow field. So, Lagrangian frame, you travel along with the fluid particles. So, you are sitting. Eulerian frame is, you are standing on a platform and seeing the train pass by. That is Eulerian frame, because the control volume, the region of interest is limited by your field of vision and you are seeing what is coming in and what is going out. So, now I am going to sit as a fluid particle and go from say Z 1 location to Z 2 location. Obviously, common sense tells me that this fluid is going to get heated, because it has gotten heated from 25 to 60 somewhere. So, it is going to get heated as it moves. Now, if it gets heated, definitely we know that no slip condition or no temperature gradient condition will impose that the first layer is at 80. That does not change. But if heat is coming in, what is happening? Next layer of fluid, which was at 79, will be at 79. These inside layers, which were at 75 and all, will now start to increase in temperature. So, what I get is the layers which were cooler here in the center also will start to become hot. So, essentially what will happen is, with time this fluid, for this I have to explain thermal boundary layer. Let us just explain that first. So, when a flow is coming into the flow field, into the pipe with velocity u infinity and inlet temperature T infinity, let us say this is T s is constant. What happens? We are talking of internal flow. So, the first time the fluid enters here, this is z equal to 0, or books will call x equal to 0, I do not care, whatever this is the flow direction. This is my radial direction r, and sometimes book will refer to as y, where y is equal to r minus r, and capital R is the radius of the pipe. Okay. Once the fluid enters, just as you have a hydrodynamic boundary layer formed, a thermal boundary layer will also be formed. What does that mean? The layer of the fluid which is in contact with the heated surface will have the same temperature. The next layer will see a dip in temperature, following and further you will see temperature which is close to the inlet temperature. Okay. Now, in fluid mechanics, we had only two quantities, u mean and u infinity, correct? The variables were like that, and in fact, sir has used v or u. Let me just go back, I do not want to change notations. Yeah, we have used v here, so we will stick with v in this also. So, v mean or average velocity and u infinity. So, I have only two things to deal with, and when we said fully developed hydrodynamic flow, we said d v by d z is equal to 0. So, the velocity profile does not change with respect to the flow direction after the hydrodynamic entrance length is reached. I hope you are with me on this. Let us just go back. Yeah, here. See, this is the boundary layer, velocity boundary layer which is formed. Okay. So, we all know that this is uniform velocity. Inside the boundary layer, there is a gradient. Outside of the boundary layer, in this part, the flow remains at velocity u infinity. Is it u infinity or greater than u infinity? It is going to be greater than u infinity in this portion, central core, because the fluid will get accelerated, because the fluid has slowed down inside the boundary layer. M dot has to remain constant. Whether you do m dot integral or m dot by this average value, the mass flow rate is constant. So, because the flow has gotten slow in this part, imagine a circular pipe. So, in closer to the walls, the fluid has gotten slow. So, the fluid will accelerate in this part, and after that slowly the central core will get slower and slower, and finally the boundary layers will meet at the center, and beyond that point we call as a fully developed flow. Very nice, very easy mathematical condition is dV by dx or dV by dz equal to 0. Now, what I am saying is in fluid mechanics things were good. In heat transfer, what is going to happen? As I said, a boundary layer will be formed. This boundary layer is going to be formed because of a difference in the fluid and the surface temperature. So, in this part, let us say T s is greater than T infinity. In this part, let us say the temperature was like this, T s fixed. So, the temperature was T s, in this part it is going to be lower than T s, lower than T s, lower than T s. What happens here? Based on the amount of heat that is put, this temperature would basically, the boundary layer will be formed, or the fluid will feel the effect of this heat transfer based on its properties. Whether the boundary layer is this thick or this thick will be based on the fluid property, which is nu over alpha essentially. So, what this tells me is in this part the temperature remains like this. Now, if I go further, obviously, because the fluid is being heated, what is going to happen? We have a constraint of this surface temperature being fixed. So, the surface temperature is fixed. Let me go, I will have to draw it again. I will take a long pipe. Let me draw the boundary layer like this, and let us say in this part, this is the temperature distribution. Because this has been fixed at T subscript s, at a next location you have transferred heat from the outside to the fluid, this also has to be at T surface s, and the temperature distribution will become a little bit more fat. Okay. And this fatness or this size of this profile is essentially a measure of the heat content or heat that has gone into the fluid. Now, what happens is, because the flow is an internal flow, the boundary layers will tend to meet. The point of the location where the boundary layers meet is going to be called as the thermal entry length. This thermal entrance length is essentially similar to your hydrodynamic entrance length, entry region, where the boundary layers have come together. After that, what is happening? The entire region, entire flow field has become viscous. Viscous effects are important here. In this portion, this was the inviscid portion of the flow, this was the viscous portion of the flow. After the merger of the boundary layers, this is in the hydrodynamically fully developed region. The velocity profile is parabolic, this is completely viscous flow. Now, here what is happening? This has been shown for a case where T s is smaller than T infinity. That means the fluid is losing heat. Nevertheless, the location of the thermal boundary layer is shown. This is the thermal entrance length, and after that we have this region called as a so called thermally fully developed region. I say this so called thermally fully developed because there is a problem associated with it. Now, why all this story? The story is being told because of two or three reasons. First thing, fluid mechanics, we had U m and U infinity. Here I have T surface, I have T surface, okay. I have T infinity, which is the inlet temperature, which I generally do not care too much about. T local, that means what? At every location, here, here, A, B, C, the same A would have had a new temperature now, A prime, B prime will have a new temperature. So, there is a local temperature, which is a function of R, comma x, and unlike my velocity, where I could define a U m, here I have to define the so called bulk mean temperature, which is a representative temperature that you as an engineer has to give for application. So, in heat exchangers, all of us have studied, oil enters at so and so temperature, it is flowing through a pipe. We know for a fact that the temperature closest to the wall at this location is going to be different, and it is going to be different at every point. So, this bulk mean temperature, we are going to say what it is. So, this bulk mean temperature is essentially obtained by energy balance. What are we doing? We take energy, essentially is m dot Cp T mean or bulk mean temperature, this one. That is equal to, so what is this mixing cup temperature is, you take this fluid out of the pipe, it has a temperature profile, take it into a cup and stir it, mix it and put in a thermometer. Whatever the thermometer measures is called as the mixing cup temperature. That is the name, mixing cup. The fluid is well mixed and it has a uniform homogeneous temperature. From thermodynamic point of view, we say that thermal equilibrium is there. Otherwise, what is happening? Every molecule of the fluid which is at a higher temperature will give energy to the molecule at a lower temperature, and therefore, there will be some heat transfer between the fluid molecules. So, this is the mixing cup temperature. Physically, that is the mixing cup temperature. Now, mathematically, what do I do? So, as professor has pointed out, if you take a ring element, that ring element, there is an associated mass flow rate. So, this is d A, there is an associated mass flow rate, there is an associated temperature. This is what is a local temperature. Now, imagine the pipe. If this ring is closer to the wall, the local temperature is going to be higher in case of heating. If this ring is closer to the center, the local temperature is going to be lower. So, this energy content of this fluid element, remember we are talking of a fluid element. So, this dm Cp m Cp T. So, I am going to write dm Cp and temperature. This, when I integrate over the entire area, that is going to be the same as the energy content of this fluid element, and that is what is shown here. E fluid, E dot fluid, energy content of the fluid element is m dot Cp Tm, is nothing but integrated over the mass, entire mass, which essentially translates to integration over the area, dm dot Cp local temperature T. And this, when I write mathematically, it is just going to be m dot Cp T m is equal to integral rho d A is, in U is going to be a local velocity, d A is 2 pi r d r for the pipe, Cp T of r comma x. So, I have a local velocity and I have a local temperature. So, we are talking of product of two distributions, which has to be integrated from r is equal to 0 to r is equal to capital R. This m dot is nothing but rho pi r squared, if I am talking of a circular pipe, rho pi r squared u mean or v mean, bulk mean velocity, rho a v. So, I can write therefore, next page. Therefore, from this equation I can write T mean or bulk mean temperature is essentially what? Integral 0 to capital R rho C p u of r comma x T of r comma x 2 pi r d r, this divided by m dot C p coming from the left hand side, which is rho pi r squared u m and C p. Okay. And if I am saying it is constant properties, which is what we are going to assume, this gets cancelled, pi gets cancelled here, cancelling pi here. So, I am left with 2 by u m r squared integral 0 to r r u of r comma x T of r comma x dr. This is your bulk mean temperature or mixing cup temperature or average temperature, which you are going to give in your problems. And see, it looks so complicated because it involves a velocity distribution. And let us think of it logically. If the flow is going to be very, very fast, okay, very high speed flows, or let us take the example of your geyser at home. When the flow is very slow, velocity is small, the fluid is going to take, there is going to be time for the fluid to take the heat, therefore, the temperature is going to be higher. So, this is where the velocity distribution comes in, this is where the temperature distribution comes in. So, fluid mechanics is completely involved in this part. Okay. So, unless I know the velocity field, I cannot get this so called bulk mean temperature. And this bulk mean temperature is essentially this definition. Now, do we have to mug up this definition? Absolutely no. It can come from fundamentals, which we have shown. So, please understand that it is a coupling of the velocity and the temperature distribution, that is what is shown here. So, with this definition of bulk mean temperature, let us move ahead. So, this bulk mean temperature, where is this going to be used? I said in heat transfer, we have lot of headache, because I have T surface, which can be a constant or varies with x. If I have a constant heat flux condition, heat flux is equal to constant condition, this would imply that wall surface temperature is not a constant, it is going to vary with x. We have a local temperature, which is r comma x, and now we have this new concept, which we like, because it is more convenient to use, that is bulk mean temperature. And this we know is a function of x alone. How do I know it is a function of x alone? Because it is obtained by a integration in the r direction. So, because of this integration, this r dependency of T is completely lost. So, I am going to get T m of x is going to be a function of x alone. Now, mathematically we are telling, physically, realistically what we are saying, if water comes in at 25 degrees centigrade and the surface is being heated by electrical heating, whatever be it, we know that there is going to be a local temperature difference, the profile is going to be like this. But bulk mean temperature, if I put a thermometer at this point versus a thermometer at this point, they are going to measure this T 1 is going to be lower than T 2. Bulk mean temperature is lower here as compared to this point. So, fluid is getting hotter, obviously. So, this is going to be only a function of the x direction, because by definition the radial dependency is absorbed in the definition of the bulk mean temperature. But local temperature, of course, is going to be a function of r comma x. And this is something which we have to emphasize to our students. Maybe students do not understand it or teachers do not understand, but we have to emphasize this point that bulk mean temperature varies only with respect to the axial direction or the flow direction. Okay. Now, what is this business of thermally fully developed? So, there is a little difficulty in understanding this, from because what is fully developed? Hydrodynamically fully developed, let us just go back to our drawing. Hydrodynamically fully developed, we have understood that dV by, I do not have it here. So, anyway, I will write it again. Hydrodynamically fully developed, we wrote this condition dV by dx is equal to 0. Velocity does not change in the x direction. So, if I take a picture or a velocity distribution at this point when the flow is fully developed, at some other location the profile is identical. Now, let me argue from a thermal point of view. I have a fluid, the boundary layers have met, my temperature distribution has come like this at this point x 1. Now, let me, I am supplying heat into this pipe. This pipe length is not of concern to us. Let us say the pipe length is very long. I do not care about the length. So, I am taking two locations x 1 and x 2 and I am going to argue something. What we are going to argue, let us see. So, I am supplying heat, the boundary layers have met, velocity has become fully developed. So, let us say Prandtl number is of the order 1. So, both hydrodynamic and thermal boundary layers are of the same thickness, which means they are going to meet roughly at the same point. So, let us say this is your hydrodynamic entry length and your thermal entry length. Okay. Now, from a point of view of heat transfer, let us ask this question. I am supplying heat, this is my temperature distribution. Let us say the surface temperature was 70 degrees centigrade and the center line temperature of the fluid was say 35 degrees centigrade. Now, if I add more heat, logically I am, since I am going to heat the fluid, if heat flux is constant, the wall temperature will have to rise. So, this temperature obviously at a different location is going to be, let us say, 75 degrees centigrade. And because the fluid has gotten hot, the center line, the center portion of the flow also would have got a hot. So, this, let us say, has gone up to 40 degrees centigrade. So, what is happening to this profile? This profile is essentially swelling. It is swelling in the direction of flow, and finally, if the length is very, very long, you will come up with a temperature distribution which looks very, very fat like this. Okay. What it tells me that because of heat transfer, if I have Q is equal to 0, all this business does not happen at all. Where hydrodynamics was very good, because once the boundary layers have met, fluid does not care what happened to the inlet or what is the boundary condition. Here I have a problem, because I am supplying heat, there at every different axial location, for every different axial location there is a heat addition. So, the temperature profile T of r comma x at this location is going to be different at this location. So, now fully developed dV by dx is equal to 0, I could write. Now, can I write dT by dx equal to 0? We have argued now that velocity profile becomes thicker and thicker. So, dT by dx, I cannot write that equal to 0, because local temperature changes along the flow direction. Okay, so let us not even worry about thermally fully developed. Well, that is not the case. Thermally fully developed flow can be understood, can be established by understanding this concept. What it says is this: as the flow progresses from here to here, if I define what are the variables, what are the variables associated with the flow, I have written this several times, let us write it again here: T S, T local, T bulk mean. Please remember that the free stream or T infinity is long forgotten, that is no longer going to come into the picture. So, I have three different temperatures that I have to deal with, and T s of x, T mean of x and T r comma x. So, from this it looks that flow will never become thermally fully developed, but we can say, let us do this carefully. If I write a temperature, non-dimensional temperature, which looks like this, T s of x minus T r comma x, I will tell you what this is, T s of x minus T m comma x. If I write this temperature, what is this? This, let us take the pipe again, T s is the surface temperature, T is the local temperature, and T m is this bulk mean temperature, which is the integrated effect of U and T. In fully developed, we are trying to define thermally fully developed flow situation. So, what we are saying, when can a flow be called as thermally fully developed? That is, after the boundary layers have met, when the thermal boundary layers have met, if I define this T s minus T local divided by T s minus T m, this ratio has been found to be invariant with respect to x. So, d by d x of, let me just go back and show this to you again, d by d x of T s minus T local divided by T s minus T m is equal to 0. What it means is that this temperature profile, which we kept drawing repeatedly, this temperature profile, if I draw once more here, this is a profile which is like this. This is another location where I am going to make it little bigger purposely and make it a little fatter. Okay, so, T s 1, T s 2, this is a local temperature T s. I mean, sorry, T of r comma x, this is another T of r comma x, there is a T bulk mean 1, T bulk mean 2. What it tells me at x 1 and x 2, if the flow is to be called as thermally fully developed, this derivative of this non-dimensional temperature difference. So, T s 1 or T s 1 minus T local divided by T s 1 minus T m 1 is equal to T s 2 minus T r comma x divided by T s 2 minus T m 2. That means, what? This ratio does not change with respect to x. In other words, this is mathematical. Physically, what it tells me is that this thing is becoming fatter as it moves. I am talking of heat going into the fluid. Fluid is getting heated. As this thing is getting expanded, as it is getting bloated up, it gets bloated up in such a way that this condition, mathematical condition, is satisfied. What it means is that this surface temperature has increased, this fluid temperature locally also would have increased, and correspondingly the bulk mean temperature, which is obtained by integration of this local temperature distribution, that has also changed. And the change is in such a way that this ratio does not, this ratio derivative of this is equal to 0, or this ratio does not change with respect to the flow direction. This is what I will call as a thermally fully developed condition. Now, what it means is that the shape of this profile is going to be such that the heat transfer characteristics will be such that this condition has to be satisfied. Okay, so, the non-dimensional temperature gradient, this has not come from magic, this has come because we, in fluid mechanics, we could write d by d x of V m is equal to 0. I had to deal only with V m, okay. I did not have to deal with any other quantity, this is the average velocity. But here, because this T m is dependent on local as well as the surface boundary condition, which is the T surface, which is not going to be a constant, which in constant heat flux condition it will vary. In constant wall temperature condition, even though this is constant, because heat is being transferred, the fluid is going to get hotter or cold depending on the direction of flow. So, this represents mathematically the thermally fully developed condition. There will be a lot of questions on this, we will take it later on. So, beyond this point, I can write mathematically that this non-dimensional temperature profile would remain the same. This non-dimensional temperature distribution, let me call this, is going to be invariant with respect to the axial flow direction. Okay, so much for that. So, if now comes the mathematical aspects of it. In a thermally fully developed flow, this derivative T s minus T divided by T s minus T m with respect to x is 0, we have written that mathematically, this derivative is equal to 0. What does it mean? If a derivative is 0, that means this quantity is not a function of x, is independent of x. Obviously, it is going to expand in such a way that this non-dimensional ratio is going to have the same value at different x locations. Okay. If this is, for this whole thing is not a function of x, then obviously, its derivative with respect to the other flow direction r must not be a function of x. What am I saying? If d by dx of T s of x minus T of r comma x divided by T s of x minus T mean comma x is equal to 0, means this bracket T s of x minus T of r comma x divided by T s of x minus T m of x is not a function of x. If this is not a function of x, derivative of this quantity with respect to r, d by dr of this is obviously not a function of x. Mathematics, you can take any function and see it is going to be independent of the other variable. So, because this is not a function of x, why am I doing this? Let us just understand why am I doing this. I am doing this for a very simple reason, because my heat transfer coefficient is defined how? Minus k dt by dy at y equal to 0 divided by T s minus T infinity. Remember, I had drawn the pipe and I had changed the coordinate axis also. This is I called as y and this is r, and I said y is equal to r minus r. So, dy is equal to minus dr. So, my heat transfer coefficient therefore, I can write as minus k dt by dy at y equal to 0 would become k dt by dr at r is equal to capital R divided by T s minus T infinity. This is also, this is exactly the same thing written in terms of the r variable, not the y variable, just by using this coordinate transform. When y equal to 0, r is equal to capital R, that is what I have used. So, I want this dt by dr. When do I want this dt by dr? I want this dt by dr for thermally fully developed condition. If flow is not thermally fully developed, I cannot do anything. This is, we are trying to get some kind of a logical solution for the heat transfer coefficient when the flow is thermally fully developed. And thermally fully developed condition comes from this huge expression, which says that this is not a function of x. So, this I want to take this derivative with respect to r of this quantity. I cannot take directly of this quantity. So, I have to take for this quantity which represents the fully developed, thermally fully developed condition. So, when I do the maths here, I am going to get the denominator is essentially a function of x. So, let me write here, denominator is only a function of x. So, it comes out, it is not going to be involved in the differentiation. This is going to be a function of x. So, derivative of this is equal to 0. So, I essentially have this quantity. And what am I saying? I am saying that 1 over T s of x minus T m of x times d by d r of the second term in the numerator. So, it is going to be minus d by d r of T of r comma x is not a function of x. Correct? How did we come up with this? We argued in the last set of slides. We said that because this is not a function of x, the derivative of this quantity with respect to r is also not a function of x. So, I will write, which means minus d by dr of t of r comma x, I am going to stop writing this r comma x, evaluated at r equal to capital R is not a function of x. And now, in couple of steps, I am going to come up with this definition of heat Nusselt number minus k dt by dy at y equal to 0. This is nothing but k dt by dr at r equal to capital R. This quantity, I am going to recast here in the form of Nusselt number. Q is h times T s minus T m. I will come to this derivative, this thing. Q is therefore nothing but heat flux. Heat flux is minus k d T by d y at y equal to 0. It is nothing but k d T by d r at r equal to r. And this k d T by d r is nothing but this quantity. I will substitute from here. So, I can write, let me just go back here. So, heat transfer coefficient is minus k d T by plus k d T by d r at r equal to r divided by T s minus T m. Why T m? Because we no longer need to use T infinity, because in internal flow T infinity has no meaning. T m takes over the same role as T infinity. In external flow, T infinity was a constant. The driving heat transfer, the heat transfer was driven by this temperature difference T s minus T infinity. In internal flow, because T m is going to change at every location, heat transfer is going to be governed by this temperature difference. So, the representative temperature difference is what I am going to deal with. So, h times T s minus T m is equal to k d T by d r. What does this tell me? D T by d r I have shown is not a function of x. Okay. So, this quantity therefore, heat transfer coefficient k d T by d r by T s minus T m, this quantity is not a function of x. So, in thermally fully developed region, this local convective heat transfer coefficient is a constant. Is a constant means it is independent of the x direction. So, mathematically we have shown this h by definition is, let me go back, h by definition is k d T by d r at r equal to r divided by T s minus T m, correct. So, this quantity we said is not a function of x. So, it is whatever location in the pipe that you are taking after the flow has become thermally fully developed, this quantity is going to be a constant. And therefore, I will say this, if this is a constant, this also has to remain a constant. So, h is independent of the axial direction in case of thermally fully developed situation. Okay. So, this is a major, this has lot of implications actually in concepts, I mean in the practical applications, heat transfer coefficient remains constant. Okay. So, if you have understood this, we try to plot this quantity variation of friction factor and heat transfer coefficient in the flow direction. This is the pipe and you have thermal boundary layer, we have drawn this for P r greater than 1, hydrodynamic boundary layer is slightly thicker than thermal boundary layer. This is the hydrodynamic entry length where the flow has become hydrodynamically fully developed. This is the thermal fully developed entrance length after which the flow is thermally fully developed. We are showing the friction factor is constant in this part for laminar flow, heat transfer coefficient is constant beyond this point for the thermally fully developed. So, what and the, of course, these are correlations. Hydrodynamic entry length is 0.05 R e times d, thermal entry length is 0.05 R e P r times d. Okay. So, these are just correlations. So, variation of Nusselt number along a tube in turbulent flow for both a uniform surface temperature and heat flux, this we will study a little later. Why, I just want to tell you a couple of things. In real life situations, internal flow real life problems, we deal with two boundary conditions. Q s or Q wall is constant and T s is equal to constant, T s or T wall surface temperature. Why these two? Because these two situations lend themselves to some kind of a logical analytical solution. Most real life problems are neither this nor this, but we can model them to be either one of these conditions, so that things are easier to control. Okay, from experimental point of view, you can at least try to get some kind of a comparison. So, that is why in our study, we are going to deal with one of these two boundary conditions, that is either wall heat flux is constant or wall surface temperature is maintained constant. This is what we will first talk about. We will then go to the surface temperature equal to constant case.